If the ushers will come forward at this time, we'll receive the evening tithes and offerings. We're going to be here until about 8:30 studying the Bible. If you're not prepared to stay until 8:30, then we would suggest that you leave now. People not knowing us, you know, come and sometimes they think, oh man, I didn't know you were going to have this long a Bible study. And they get up and leave during the study, and that's not good. It distracts people from the study of the Word. So you can go over to the fellowship hall and you can watch on the closed circuit TV, and then you can leave from there anytime you please. And because it's dark, it won't be as distracting. But We ask you that once the Bible study has started, that you not leave the auditorium. And if you do have an emergency where you have to leave, then realize that you won't be able to come back in to the service until it is concluded. So if you have an emergency and have to leave and say to your wife, I've got to go out, and then if she doesn't, she wonders, why didn't he come back? It's because the ushers at the door will request that you not return into the service. So he hasn't disappeared or been raptured or something personally. It's just that that's just the way it is. And so we appreciate your cooperating with us on that particular matter. This week is going to be another exciting week, with each night filled with the study of the Word of God. And we encourage you to consult the bulletin, and it will show you all the opportunities that you have of growing in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We do have a very interesting and unusual kind of a situation right now, in that there are a few openings in the ladies' retreat in March. And so if you in the past have tried to sign up and found out that everybody has signed up already, because we can take more ladies at Murrieta than we could at the conference center, for some reason we do have just a very few openings left for the March retreat. So if you get into the office tonight, you can probably get an assured reservation without having to be put on the waiting list. I would say by next Sunday, the waiting list will get started. So this is a word to the wise, and they say that that is sufficient. Let's turn in our Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 10. There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius. He was a centurion of the band called the Italian Band. In the Bible, we are introduced to different centurions. They all of them seem to be of high character. A centurion was over 100 soldiers in the Roman army. You remember there was a centurion in Capernaum who had a servant who was very sick. And the people came and they said to Jesus, this fellow has helped us build our synagogue. He's a good man, and he is worthy. And so Jesus said, I will come and heal his servant. So as Jesus was on the way to the house to heal the servant, word came to the centurion that Jesus was coming to his house, and his wife probably said, "Honey, the house is a mess. The servant's sick, hasn't been able to clean the place, and we can't have the Lord coming here and all. Look, can't." So he sent other messengers back and said, "Don't bother coming. I understand authority. I'm a man of authority, and I have under authority, and I have under me men. And I can say to one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes. And I know that all you have to do is speak the word, and my servant will be healed." Not necessary you come to the house. Just speak the word. Jesus commended him. He said, "I haven't found this kind of faith in all of Israel. From among the Israelites, he had not seen such faith as was manifested by this Roman centurion." When Jesus was crucified, it was a centurion standing near the cross when he saw the events of the crucifixion who said, "Surely this was the Son of God." Now we have Cornelius, another centurion. He's in Caesarea, which was the Roman capital of that area. The Roman magistrates ruled from Caesarea. And we are told in verse 2 that he was a devout man, one that feared God with all of his house. And he gave much alms to the people, and he was a man of prayer. So, very commendable. He lived a good life. He was seeking God. He feared God. He prayed. And he gave alms to the people. Now, here is a second case in the book of Acts where we find a person who is outside of the covenant nation who is devout and seeking God. We remember earlier we were introduced to the Ethiopian eunuch who was the treasurer of Ethiopia under Candace, the queen, who had come to Jerusalem to worship God and was returning to Ethiopia. And we remember how that God sent Philip all the way down by direct revelation to this area in the Gaza Strip to meet the man in order that he might introduce him to the understanding of Jesus Christ from the scriptures. So a man searching for God, and God by divine direction sent someone to him so that his search for God could be fulfilled, so he could find God. Now, here's another man. He's a Roman. He's a centurion. And yet he is searching for God. He is praying. He's probably been introduced to Judaism, to the idea of one God. He has come from the pagan roots of Romanism, or from Rome with all of its many gods, and to the belief in the one God, and he is praying, and he is helping the poor, and he's a devout man. And again, God, by divine intervention and by divine revelation, is going to meet this thirsty soul by sending, by divine revelation, someone to share with him the way of God more completely, so that he can come into a full understanding and relationship with God. So he saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming in to him and saying unto him, "Cornelius." And when he looked on him, he was afraid. And he said, "What is it, Lord?" And he said unto him, "Your prayers and your alms are come up for a memorial before God." And now send men to Joppa and call for one Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lodging with one Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the seaside, and he shall tell thee what you ought to do. So God is going to meet this man whose hunger is for God with a fuller revelation. And notice how the angel specifically instructs him on just where Peter is and gives him implicit instructions of how he might come to a fuller, richer revelation and understanding of God. So when the angel which departed, he called two of his household servants and a devout soldier of them that waited on him continually. And when he had declared all of these things unto them, he sent them to Joppa. It's about a 30-mile journey, 25, 30 miles between Caesarea and Joppa. And so two of his servants and one of his soldiers to accompany them were sent to Joppa. Now on the next day, the morrow, as they went on their journey and were drawing nigh to the city, Peter went up on the housetop to pray about the sixth hour. It's interesting to me how that God always works on both ends. It wasn't just, you know, God working in the heart of Cornelius and instructing him, but now on the other end, God's going to work in the heart of Peter. So God working on both ends brings his purposes to pass. I have had many people come to me and declare that God has spoken to them for me. And they have a message from the Lord for me. Now, I have found that quite often God has already been working in my own heart on that issue. So that God was working on both ends. And as they come, it is a confirmation to me of those things that God has been speaking to my heart. Other times, they're off the wall kind of things. And I pass them off. Because I do believe that when God is dealing with you, he works on both ends. If someone just came and say, you know, we had a vision and you're supposed to come down to Tijuana and start a ministry there, I would hesitate unless the Lord had, you know, given me a great desire for tamales and enchiladas and, you know, and shown me a vision of ministering among the Mexicans or something, you know. So it's something that God works on both ends. He'll work in your heart, and oftentimes then the work is confirmed by someone coming and sharing with you. So Peter had gone up to pray, 6 hours, noon. He became very hungry, and he would have eaten. But while they were making ready food, he fell into a trance. And he saw heaven open and a certain vessel descending unto him, as it had been a great canvas knit at the four corners, and it was let down to the earth. And there were all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth, wild beast, creeping things, and fowls of the air. And there came a voice to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "No way, Lord." And it is really in the Greek a little bit stronger than "not so." "I'll have none of it." literally. That's sort of interesting, though. I'll have none of it, Lord. The Lord had given him a commandment. Rise, Peter, kill and eat. I'll have none of it, Lord. See, that really isn't consistent, is it? It's sort of the inconsistencies, I think, that oftentimes we have when we argue with the Lord or when we are fighting against what the Lord is saying to us. Now, the voice spoke to him the second time. First time, the voice said, rise, Peter, kill and eat. And he refused, saying, I've never eaten anything that is common or unclean. And the voice spoke to him the second time, what God has cleansed, call not thou common or uncleansed. And this was done 3 times, and the vessel went up again into heaven. Now, as far as the Jew was concerned, the Gentile nations were unclean. And in a person with Jewish background, strong Jewish roots, it is extremely difficult to arise over the hold that tradition has on you. Traditions many times are stronger than doctrine. And we hold to the traditions, they are not doctrinally sound. Peter, growing up in the Jewish tradition, looked upon the Gentiles as unclean. And is going to bring into Peter a very radical and dramatic change. The realization that God will save Gentiles. The Jews did not believe that a Gentile could be saved. They believed that the only hope for a Gentile, as far as salvation was concerned, was to become a Jew. They had to proselytize into the Jewish faith in order to be saved. And this was the feeling of the early church. It was their feeling that a Jew could not be saved. I mean, that a Gentile could not be saved. He'd have to become a Jew in order to be saved. Now, the Lord is trying to break Peter from this tradition. And it should be noted that though he began to break him down, it wasn't, Peter still had problems with this later on. Later on in the Gentile church of Antioch, where Paul was ministering, Peter came up to visit the church. And he ate with the Gentiles until there were certain of the church from Jerusalem who came on up. And then he separated himself and wouldn't eat with the Gentiles. And it caused a division in the church of Antioch. So that Paul rebuked Peter to the face because of his creating this division, because even Barnabas was carried division that took place there in Antioch, separated himself and would only eat with the Jews and not with the Gentiles. So it's a difficult thing to overcome deep-seated traditional background. With Peter, it took a direct work of God's Holy Spirit to deal with him on this issue. And so It took three times this vision that he saw. Do you suppose that three times he said, "Not so, Lord"? And it, you know, the Lord had to say to him, "Don't call that unclean, which I have cleansed." Now, wondered in himself, or was perplexed, what this vision might mean. Behold, the men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house, and they stood before the gate. They had arrived in Joppa, and they inquired around, "Where does Simon live?" And so they were directed to Simon's house, and were now at the gate of the house. And they called, and they asked whether Simon, whose surname was Peter, was staying there. And when Peter thought on this vision, the Spirit said unto him, "Behold, three men are seeking you." Now, Peter didn't know what this is all about. What does this mean? And so the Lord now is going to clarify the vision to him. And the Lord will speak as directly to Peter as he did to Cornelius, the things that are happening. So the Lord said unto him, "There are three men who are seeking you. Arise therefore and get down and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them." Now Peter still doesn't know what's going on. He knows he's had a strange vision. He knows that the Lord has sort of rebuked him. The Lord has told him that he has cleansed things that Peter isn't ready to accept as being clean. And so the command to just arise and don't doubt, "I've sent them." So Peter went down to the men that were sent unto him from Cornelius, and he said, "Behold, I'm the one you're looking for. For what cause have you come?" And they said, "A just man and one that fears God and is of good report among the nation of the Jews was warned from God by a holy angel to send you to come to his house that he might hear words from you." So Peter now is beginning to understand. Cornelius the centurion, he's not a Jew, but God has spoken to him. He is favorable to Jewish people. He's a devout man, and God is speaking to him. So he called them in and lodged them. Now, prejudices are beginning to break down. It was an unthinkable thing to invite a Gentile into your home. Every place that he would sit down would be considered unclean. If you would sit down where he had sat in a chair, then you would be unclean. They felt that this ceremonial uncleanness could be transmitted by touching, or touching something that a Gentile had touched. And so to invite them in to spend the night was of the breakdown of the prejudice. And on the next day, Peter went with them, and he took certain brethren from Joppa. Now, these of them were Jews, and I think that Peter suspicioned God's going to do something, and I want witnesses. And so he took six men with him from the church in Joppa, that if God should happen to do something among the Gentiles, He'd have people that could back up his story. Because when we get into the next chapter, we find that Peter was called on the carpet for going to the Gentiles. They heard in Jerusalem that the Gentiles had received the Holy Spirit and all. And when Peter came back to Jerusalem, they began to contend with him. They said, "You went to the Gentiles." And so Peter had to tell them the story of how it was that he went. But they were calling him on the carpet for going to the Gentiles. Healing was very strong. It's hard for us to imagine the racial prejudice that did exist in their hearts and minds. So the next day they entered Caesarea, and Cornelius was waiting for them. And he had called together his kinsmen and his close friends. And as Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and bowed down at his feet and worshiped him. And that worship doesn't mean that he's actually worshiping Peter, but he bowed down in the Oriental custom of bowing and doing obeisance. But Peter took him up, saying, "Stand up, I myself am also a man." Refusing to receive the adulation or the worship of this man. Herein is a real problem. When a person has been used of God, a person has been gifted by the Holy Spirit, and has been an instrument through which God has brought help, blessing, sometimes healing to a person, it is very common for people to then begin to hold that person in high regards, to sort of elevate them in their minds above others, thinking that they are closer to God, thinking that they have some special inroads to God, and they sort of hold them in reverence and adulation. In fact, they sometimes even start calling them reverend, or they start calling them the most reverend, or the most right reverend. And they start adding titles to the titles as they are elevating that individual. Now, the danger is when the individual begins to receive that adulation and tries to stand on the pedestal that they are building for him. Peter was always careful, as were the apostles, not to allow the people to hold them up on a pedestal, elevate them and exalt them above the others. Peter didn't say, "Kiss my ring, man." If he were the first pope. But he said, "Stand up, I'm just a man." And as he talked with him, he went in and found many that were come together. Now I'm certain that as Peter walked in the door, It was probably the most difficult step he had ever taken. He had never been in the house of a Gentile in his life. It was strictly forbidden by their interpretation of the law to enter the house of a Gentile. And yet, in the back of his mind, he could see this sheet, he could see all of these animals, and he could hear the Lord saying, "Don't call that unclean which I have cleansed." So, against all of the prejudice, traditional, he stepped over the threshold into the house. And there were many that had come together. It was a great gathering of people there in the house of Cornelius. And he said unto them, "You know that it is unlawful for a man that is a Jew to keep company or to come into one of another nation. But God has shown me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Therefore, I came unto you without argument as soon as I was sent for. And now I ask you, what is the purpose for which you have sent for me? And Cornelius said, 4 days ago, I was fasting unto this hour, and at the ninth hour, I prayed in my house, and behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing. And he said, 'Cornelius, your prayer is heard, and your alms are had in remembrance in the sight of God.'" God heard his prayers. God was cognizant of this man's generosity, his concern and care for the poor. And so this man in bright clothing said, Send therefore to Joppa, call Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lodging in the house of one Simon a tanner by the seaside. And when he comes, he will speak unto you. Immediately, therefore, I sent to you, and you have well done that you are come. Now, therefore, we are all of us here present before God to hear the things that have been commanded to you by God. We're here to hear God's word. And for you, we did it. It's good that you've come. We've gathered together. We want to hear God's word. So Peter opened his mouth and said, "I perceive that God is no respecter of persons." Now, God had declared that way back in Deuteronomy. It was a reoccurring theme. He declared he was no respecter of persons. It was something that was spoken of in the Psalms. And of course, it's a theme that Paul picks up many times in the New Testament, because Paul was the apostle to the Gentiles. So Peter is coming. "I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. But in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him." In other words, he is understanding that you don't have to be a Jew to be a Christian. God will accept a Gentile who seeks him. Now, he's not saying you can be saved apart from Jesus Christ. You see, here was a man who was sincerely seeking God. God made provisions for this man to hear the gospel that he might be saved. God accepted his prayer. God acknowledged heart, and God sent his word that he might have the Jesus Christ in order that he might be saved. It's not saying that you can be saved apart from the revelation of Jesus Christ. acknowledging that God will judge a man according to the light and the understanding that that man has. Living up to, in Luke chapter 12, Jesus gives that story of the Lord who went away into a far country, leaving his goods in charge with a steward who, when the Lord did not return after a prolonged period of time, said, well, my Lord delays his coming, and he began to abuse his position. He began to be drunken and abuse those that were under his authority. So that the Lord came an hour when he was not expecting. And he took from him his position, his authority. He commanded that he be given over to punishment. And then the Lord said, for he who knew the will of the Lord and did not according will be beaten with many stripes. Yet he who did things that were worthy of many stripes because he did not know will be beaten with few. Unto whom much is given, much is required. So there is always that issue. Well, what about a person who has never heard about Jesus Christ? The Lord will not be unfair when he judges. He'll be righteous when he judges. And a person will be judged according to the light and the understanding that they have been given. That can be positive and that can be negative. If you've heard and you reject, then greater punishment than those who did things worse than you did, but yet they didn't know. And so I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. In every nation, those that fear him and work righteousness will be accepted with him. The word which God sent unto the children of Israel, the message of God of salvation came to the nation of Israel through Jesus Christ. Peace with God is possible through Jesus Christ. This message that was sent to Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. And basically, that is the peace with God that man can have through Jesus Christ. And peace with fellow man. Because as Paul points out in Ephesians chapter 2, Jesus has broken down the walls and the barriers that existed between national and ethnic groups. That as we stand before God, we all stand on the same level. God is no respecter of persons. Paul points out in his letter to the Romans that we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. He said there's no difference, and that's no difference between a Jew or Gentile. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God, nor is there any difference in the method by which we are saved. It is through faith in Jesus Christ. And so we are all on the same level when we stand before God. He's no respecter of persons. So God sent the message to Israel, the message of peace by Jesus Christ, for he is the Lord of all. Now, that word, I say that you know, because it was published throughout all of Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached. As Paul was later talking to King Agrippa, he said, Agrippa, you know these things. They weren't done in a corner. In other words, Jesus wasn't something or someone that nobody knew about. His ministry was so spectacular, everybody knew about it. They were all talking about it. It wasn't done in a corner. People all over had heard about Jesus Christ and the miracles that he did. It was a well-known fact. He didn't just minister in some little corner area in secret. And so that word was published throughout Judea. By word of mouth, it was published around. And it began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached, the ministry of Jesus. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God with him. So he speaks of the ministry of Jesus in the power of the Holy Spirit. God was with him. And Peter says, we were witnesses of all of the things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. But him God raised the third day and showed him openly. So again, the message of the resurrection, that's the message of the gospel. Identifying Jesus of Nazareth, went about doing good, filled with the Holy Spirit, healing, delivering, God was with him. In Jerusalem, he was slain, hung on a tree, but God raised him from the dead the third day. That's the message. Peter said, we were witnesses. God raised him and he showed him openly, not to all people, but unto witnesses who were chosen before of God, even to us, who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. You remember Jesus ate with them on different occasions. He said, you believe I'm a ghost, but I'll eat. And he ate with them on different occasions. And so Peter is testifying, we were witnesses. We saw him openly. Now, remember in the 14th of John, Jesus talking to his disciples said, henceforth the world seeth me no more, but you see me. And one of the disciples, Judas, said, Lord, how is it that you will manifest ourselves unto us and not unto the world? And Jesus said, well, he it is that hath my commandments and keepeth them. He that loveth me will be loved of the Father, and we will come and manifest ourselves. So after his resurrection, he did manifest himself unto those who believed, his disciples. He showed himself openly. Those who he had chosen before, foreordained, even to us. And he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which was ordained of God to be the judge of the alive, of those who are alive, judge over all. To him give all of the prophets witness that through his name whosoever believes in him shall receive the remission of sins. All of the prophets spoke of the coming of the Messiah. They all spoke of those who would believe in him would receive the remission of their sins. Now at this point, Peter's message interrupted by the Holy Spirit. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Spirit fell on all them which heard the word. There was sort of a second Pentecost of sorts. While Peter was speaking, the Holy Spirit just fell upon those who were listening. And they that had come with Peter of the circumcision, the Jews, which believed, they were astonished. Can't believe it. These people are Gentiles. God's given them the gift of the whole. Can't be. They were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, in the second chapter, when the Holy Spirit was poured out on the disciples, the 120 who were waiting, as the multitude gathered on that day, wondering what was going on, amazed, Peter preached the message of the resurrection to them. They were convicted and they said, "Men and brethren, what shall we do since we've crucified the Lord of glory?" And Peter said, "Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For this promise is unto you and to your children and to those that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call." Now, Peter had told them that on the day of Pentecost when he was talking to the Jews. I don't think that he really realized that he was saying that the gift of the Holy Spirit is going to be for all people, the Gentiles too. "But as many as the Lord our God shall call," not really realizing at that point that God would be calling a multitude of Gentiles to the faith in Jesus Christ. Though it was in the scriptures by the prophets of the Gentiles receiving the glorious gospel. So those that have come with Peter are shocked because God has given to the Gentiles the gift of the Holy Spirit. "For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God." Then Peter said, "Can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Spirit as well as we?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord, and then prayed they him to tarry certain days. They begged him to stay for a while. So here is the beginning of the Gentile church. God pouring out his Spirit and now calling out from among the Gentiles a bride for Jesus Christ, the Gentile bride of Christ. And so, beautiful, beautiful picture of the beginning of God's work among the Gentiles, of which we here tonight can give thanks to God because of the door being open to the Gentiles. We're blessed because of what God has done, in that he is no respecter of persons. He receives each one of us on an equal footing. He doesn't close the door to any man. And thus, we are wrong if we feel that one race is above or superior to another. Absolutely wrong for us to think that one man, because of his nationality or because of his ethnic background, is less than we are. There is that tendency to promote a person's ethnic background and characteristics of it, and so many ethnic groups feel that they are superior to other ethnic groups because of certain characteristics or traits or whatever. And we as Americans, and unfortunately, many of the Anglo-Saxon Americans feel that they are superior. Not so. God is no respecter of persons. No matter who the man is, no matter where he is from, if he will call upon God, he can be saved. And so it's a thrill to go into the jungles of New Guinea and see these people who still live in a primitive culture, and to go into their huts and to sit there in their huts and worship God and pray together with them. And their simple faith. Some of the greatest blessings have come in just listening to them as they talk of God in that simple faith. And I feel that, I felt as I was there that these people are miles ahead of me in their understanding and in their relationship with God, the way they relate and the way they talk about God in such a simple, beautiful way. God's no respecter of persons. Standing before God, we all stand on the same level. Father, we thank you for the power of your Holy Spirit and the gift of your Holy Spirit that you have poured out upon the Gentiles as well as the Jews. And Lord, we thank you that you have opened the door that we can come in and know the blessedness of our sins forgiven and the blessedness of fellowshipping with you. Oh Lord, we come tonight and we ask, Lord, that you will work in our hearts and in our lives. As we read, Lord, of how you directed Peter so specifically and how you directed Cornelius, Lord, we long to be in that place of close fellowship with you to the extent, Lord, that you could speak directly to us about specific issues. Lord, let our hearts be open to the fullness of your Holy Spirit and to the work of your Holy Spirit, that we might be empowered by your Spirit to do your work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tonight, over in the fellowship hall after the service, we will be having the afterglow over there. It's conducted by Ed Cornwell. And tonight, a special waiting upon God for you who desire to be baptized with the Holy Spirit, want to be filled with the Spirit, seeking the Lord for this gift of the Holy Spirit. I encourage you to go over to the fellowship hall, as there will be a group over there for the specific purpose of just opening your hearts for the fullness of God's Spirit in your life. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. We can't survive in this world without that empowering. And so if you're thirsting after more from God and the power of God's Spirit in your life, we encourage you to go over and join with those who will be there in the fellowship hall waiting upon God for the filling of the Spirit. God bless you. May you have a great week. May he fill you with his love and with his Spirit. And may he through you reach someone else with his love this week. The Lord bless thee,
Lord bless thee
and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. And be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up.
The Lord lift up.
His countenance upon thee and give thee peace.
And now, on behalf of the Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact The Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.